our Seder, taking us into dusk, into sundown. And so we are still in Passover, but tonight begins the first day of Unleavened Bread. And this is our first day of Unleavened Bread service. And so if you'll turn with me to Leviticus chapter 23, I want to share with you the requirements for this day. Leviticus 23 is going to be our go-to chapter for all of our biblical feasts. But as you turn in there, you're going to see what the Lord is saying about Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, starting at verse 5. And it says, in the first month, we're in the first biblical month, on the 14th day of the month, between sundown and complete darkness, comes Pesach, or Passover, for Adonai, the Lord. On the 15th day of the same month is the festival of matzah, or in other versions, you'll see the festival of unleavened bread, for that's what matzah means. For 7 days, you are to eat matzah, or unleavened bread. On the first day, you are to have a holy convocation. Don't do any kind of ordinary work. Bring an offering made by fire to Adonai for 7 days. On the seventh day is a holy convocation. Do not do any kind of ordinary work. And so tonight begins that first day of unleavened bread. And so this is our holy convocation. We're going into the first day of unleavened bread with a holy convocation. We're coming together in accordance with the scripture and what the Lord is commanding us. And this is why we're offering a burnt offering on tonight. As you guys will recall from previous teachings, I shared with you all out of Leviticus chapter 1 what the burnt offering means. You have your sheets before you, which helps us to understand. But the burnt offering, as the Lord translated into spiritual language for us, the burnt offering is for deliverance. As they would go and receive an animal out of either the herd or the flock, as we see it in Leviticus chapter 1, and they completely offered that animal to the Lord. They drained the blood, they skinned it, they cut it to pieces, they cut off the head, they cut away the fat, they washed the inner parts, and then they immersed all of it in the fire. The process of submitting a burnt offering before the Lord is a prescription for us for a full deliverance. And so in unleavened bread, the Lord isn't saying just on your first day of unleavened bread and in your seventh day, but he said for 7 days, present a burnt offering to me. What that means is the Lord wants to minister 7 deliverances to us. Throughout this season, he wants to minister 7 deliverances to us. He wants to remove from us 7, and 7 is going to be that number of completion. 7 things that will obstruct our path to getting into his promises for us. 7 things that are distractions from our relationship with him. 7 things that plague or oppress us or confuse or keep us out of the place of his will. He wants to remove 7 things. So he wants to do a complete move of deliverance in our lives. We'll remember that Mary Magdalene was delivered from 7 demons. Remember they said, out of whom 7 demons came. And so we see that in our walk, all types of things can attach themselves to us. But as we connect with the Lord and we participate in his Passover, applying the blood of the lamb, ingesting that lamb, becoming one with him, that death can pass over us in every area of our life, and also as we are brought into the next life with the Lord, that death passes over us, then we begin to feast on him. Feast on unleavened bread, bread without yeast, matzah. Now he is our bread of life. And I want you to turn with me to John chapter 6, because this is where we're going to see Yeshua tell the disciples that he is the bread of life. And it's so interesting, because it doesn't start with that teaching. In John chapter 6, we see Yeshua feed 5,000 men. Remember, that was men, and each one representing households, so we know that there was even more. So he feeds 5,000, the multitude at the beginning. And then later on, he actually finds his way to the other side, and the crowd is looking for him. They're trying to figure out, how did he get there? Now, the disciples know. We see that in verses 19 and 20. He walks across the lake. He crosses it on foot. As they are in the boat, he sent them ahead so he can spend time with the Father, and he walks across the lake to the other side on foot. Now, the rest of those who had been in the crowd that had been fed by Messiah didn't know that. So here we are, this is where we're going to start in verse 25, because they continued looking for him. He fed the multitude, and now they're looking for this teacher, this rabbi, this leader who's fed everyone. So in verse 25 of John chapter 6, it says, when they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? Yeshua answered, yes, indeed, I tell you, you're not looking for me because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the bread and had all you wanted. Don't work for the food which passes away, but for the food that stays on into eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For this is the one on whom God the Father has put his seal. Now, what we know about the burnt offering is that there's something in us that God wants to take away. Now, whenever he removes something in the manner of deliverance, he always refills us with his virtue, with his spirit, with himself, that we would not be a house swept clean and left empty so that the enemy will come back with seven more. He wants to make us a clean house that he could fill us, that he could live in us, for we are the temple of the living God. So at this point, what the Lord is speaking to us about is those things that we have appetite for. What are the things that we chase after in this life? This crowd was looking to be fed naturally. They were looking for food. And the scripture tells us that the appetite of the laborer is going to spur him on. It's our appetites that lead us. Those things that we are hungry for, thirsty for, yearning for, we want to feed those needs within us. Now the question is, what is driving me? What am I trying to feed right now? Because later on, we see Yeshua speaking to them about what they really should be seeking. He says that they're looking for a miracle. And their father saw the miracle of manna in the desert. Moses gave them the manna, and they said it was the bread from heaven. But in verse 33, Yeshua says, God's bread is the one who comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world. Then he continues on in 35, and he says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever trusts in me will never be thirsty. I told you that you have seen, but still don't trust. Everyone the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will certainly not turn away, for I have come down from heaven to do not my own will, but the will of the one who sent me. And this is the will of the one who sent me, that I should not lose any one of all of those he has given me, but should raise them up on the last day. Yes, this is the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and trust in him should have eternal life, and that I should raise them up on the last day. Now we remember in verse 66, from that time on, many of the disciples turned back and no longer traveled around with him. And so this teaching, they said, was a hard teaching, because he tells them that they must eat his flesh and drink his blood in verse 56. But what we're seeing here is that he is challenging us to go before him honestly and ask, God, what is it I'm hungering for that's not you? What am I chasing in the world so that it would feed me? Or what am I chasing God for that he would feed me that may be outside of his will? That I've not asked him is his will, but it's mine. And because it's my will and I feel that I need it, I'm chasing after him or after something else that I would be fed, that the holes in me would be met. What is it that I'm searching for? What's motivating me to run after something in this season? Because whatever that is, we've got to let him take that from us today. And then we can feast on him and he can fill that place. Because he says, if we feed off of him, we just read that, we will never be hungry. So the insatiable things within our soul, and I'm not just talking about feeding our flesh, because, you know, oftentimes we stop there, you know, with what's going on with my flesh. The flesh will always want what the flesh wants. But deeper than that, what does
your soul on? What is it that your heart is aching for? That maybe it feel it missed, it's not getting, it needs. What is it that your soul is yearning for? That it causes us to shift and even make decisions based off of whether I'll get those needs met. But because it's soulish, nothing ever really fills it. So we keep going and going and pressing and pressing. There are times when we can even do service or ministry out of those soulish places. We heard that on Saturday and the Saturday before. And in our dignity serves training with Jim Moynihan, we heard that there's sometimes there are our own desires that are feeding us. And we can run and run and run and work and work and work, but it's never fulfilled. It's never really met. This is what we want to look at today. And so before we start to get into it, I want to give us all a moment to look at your burnt offering sheets. And if you don't have them, they're sitting right here in the front. Well, they're in front of you, Alicia. If they don't have it, you can hand them to them. It's the same sheet. It hasn't changed. But we want to look at it and take some time to pray. We're going to go back into a place of worship. We're going to have the worship music back on again. But we're going to look at our burnt offering sheets, and we're going to ask God a question. And this is the point I want everybody to remember. We want to remember what the question is. God, what am I running after to feed me? And what am I trying to feed? Now, we may be running after him because they were running after Yeshua. But they didn't want what he was providing. They wanted what they wanted. So what am I running after? It may be God. It may not be. What am I running after to feed me? And what am I trying to feed? There's something in our souls besides that which is his will to feed us. There's something in our souls we're trying to feed, a need we're trying to meet, a hole we're trying to fill up. We want to let him show it to us today. So we're just going to pray about that. While we go into a place of worship, we're just going to pray about that. And then after a moment, just letting him minister to us, then we're going to go through our burnt offerings that we can allow him to minister to that place. That when we finally do feed off of him, because each time we give a burnt offering, each burnt offering, you'll see it in Leviticus chapter 1 and throughout Leviticus, every offering is accompanied by its grain and its drink offering. The grain offering is the matzah, is the unleavened bread. The drink offering is the wine or the juice. So for us, every time he ministers that deliverance to us, then we are to commune with him. We will literally take communion today. But more than that, every time I receive deliverance from him, I've got to partake of him. I have to eat of his flesh and drink of his blood. I have to ingest him inside of me. Because as he's pulling things out of me, I've got to then let him fill those holes, fill those gaps. And I need him to fill it with himself. Mm-hmm. And every time we do it, remember I told y'all, Mary Magdalene, 7 demons came out of her. And this is why he continues to minister to us. He continues. We've had a lifetime of hurt, a lifetime of pain, a lifetime of woundedness. Yes, we're saved. But he continues to minister to us because he came that we might have life and life more abundantly. He's not satisfied with us just not going to hell. That was Passover. This is unleavened bread. Now we're going to ingest life that we can really be alive and really live life in its fullness because we'll be complete, actually in shalom, which is a place of wholeness. And that's where I find rest. Because there's not holes, H-O-L-E, in me. Instead, the bread of life is in me, making me whole, W-H-O-L-E. And when he does that, I won't lack, I won't need for that to be fulfilled anymore. And I can shift the focus off of myself and honestly ask him, Father, how would you like me to serve? And then that's not coming from my place of neediness or woundedness or my ulterior motives that I may not even be aware are there. Instead, it's really coming from a whole, a healthy place and that godly desire to be a blessing unto the one who's first blessed me. Amen?
Amen.